everyone. Welcome to a beautiful day in Taiwan. So today, what I'll be doing is I'll be exploring Taiwan, Kaohsiung, a little bit further. And, there is like a lot of motorbikes on this side. And what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be having breakfast at this place here. I am actually not too sure what it's called in Cantonese or Chinese. Sorry, Cantonese because I'm Cantonese. In Chinese, but I've actually ordered this pancake. I'm just not sure what it is. Pancake, right? And it's got like some eggs and pork in there. And we're going to give this one a shot. I've also got some hot, sweet soy milk here with me that I've ordered exactly at this place, and we're going to give it a shot. So today what we'll be doing is we're just going to be exploring a little bit more. My plan is to have breakfast and then after go to the zoo, and I'm not too sure where today really is going to be taking me. So that's what we're going to be doing. Here is the meal right here. Here is the soy milk. What I will be doing is I'm going to add some sauce in here, because what they do is they also have some condiments on the side for you as well, like some chili and some soy sauce. So what I'll do is I'll grab this one. These must be the takeaways. I probably won't do that. I would probably just put the chili sauce here. Rah, let's put some chili sauce here. And then also some, it doesn't really have the description on it, but this is soy sauce. I've had this one here yesterday as well, but I really want to show you guys this today because this was absolutely amazing. So you can put some pepper on there as well. I'm not too sure if I want to put some pepper or salt. Actually, you know what? Let's just give it a shot for this side. Oh, I think that must have been too much. That's okay. All right, now there's some soy sauce and some chili there, but that must be for the noodles, because I believe this is what you have with this. Correct me if I am wrong. I am having this as a Western foreigner, to be honest. I don't know what this is. I don't know how to eat it. I know it is like Taiwan pancakes that they have for breakfast. So yeah, we're gonna give this one a shot, guys. All right, let me just, my chopsticks in there. All right, this is my bad. All right, guys, so let's give this one a shot. So, there's one thing that I forgot as well. I forgot to get the straw for the soy milk too. So let's do that. I got this straw for the soy milk that I can poke it in and try that as well. Taiwan is so beautiful. Look at that. So we are actually in Kaohsiung. So Kaohsiung's more of the south district, down south of the island. And so there's not many cars as there would be in Taipei, I'm assuming, but it's a little bit more quiet, and I feel like it's a very good vibe as well. All right, so here it is, guys. Here is the pancakes. We're gonna give this one a shot. So this here is what it looks like. It's got like, can you see how it's got some eggs and some spring onion in there as well? It's got a little bit of a pork in there. So actually, I don't know if this is bacon or not, but that's okay, because either way, it's going into my stomach. And I am going to try my best to be the art of eating with chopsticks. So let's go. Dip that in some soy sauce. It's a bit of a thick one. And then we're gonna give this one a shot. Wow, okay. That is absolutely great. So this pancake is like super soft, and the bacon, surprisingly, wasn't salty. It was very soft as well. So as soon as I chewed it up, had a very soft texture. But this here was interesting. This soy sauce, it was salty, but it had a little bit of a aftertaste to it. So I don't know if it was bitter. I'm gonna try and give it a shot again. Yeah, it's got like this salty aftertaste to it. It's very distinct. It kind of tastes like oyster sauce. Yeah, I think that's what it is. It might be a mix. I think maybe this is oyster sauce and not soy sauce, but the texture is a little bit lighter. So that's very interesting. So that is exactly what a Taiwan breakfast looks like. I had soy. Guys, it is the morning. Forgive me for like my terrible vocabulary right now, but I'm having soy milk right now. And the reason why, wow, there's like these cars are really, really loud. I guess like the reason why I got soy milk was because I looked at the menu in English. So this place does have a menu in English, which is absolutely great, because some places here in Taiwan only have a Chinese menu. So it's very hard for me to actually decipher what they're what the meals are like and what is the most recommended sort of dish here. But absolutely great, because this had like a menu, it had like a tick and a thumbs up for like the most popular dish, which is why I got this one. And the actual menu title of this place actually said soy milk. So I was like, if it's soy milk, then I should get soy milk, right? Which is exactly what I decided to do. So here it is. Actually, let me just tell you one thing before I start that. When they actually brought me this meal, it came with the dish right here, and it came with a bowl, and the soy milk was in the bowl itself. I actually asked for a takeaway cup because usually I don't do well with drinking or drinking anything like milk tea for a long time. Milk tea in a short period of time. You generally have it like over a long period, so like an hour and a half, which is why I asked for a takeaway cup. But yeah, you actually end up getting this in a bowl, which was very interesting. All right, so this is the soy milk sweetened version. And whoa, look at that pop up. Honestly, you can tell that's hot and steamed. Ooh, there you go. All righty. Ooh, nice and hot. You know, surprisingly, this actually does really well, like hot soy milk with like a pancake sort of mixture. Yeah, definitely a vibe. It's very, surprisingly I got sweet, but it's not as sweet as I thought it was. No, definitely not sweet. It tastes like warm, hot soy milk, and it's definitely very well matched with this meal right here. So what I'll be doing is I'm going to be just finishing this off with breakfast, and then we'll be heading straight to the train station as well as the zoo to see what we can find today or explore really. So yeah, let's go check that out, guys. All right, guys, I've just gotten to Formosa Boulevard station in Kaohsiung, and the Dome of Light is actually located here, and I am in awe of how beautiful it looks. Check this out. Oh my gosh. That's beautiful. The video doesn't actually do this justice. It's just so beautiful here. Like, have a look, like, we can see the phoenix over there. I think that's a wolf. I actually can't see that properly. Is it a wolf or a monkey? I'm not too sure. Wow, that's beautiful. So I've actually got to go to the orange line, but this is actually so beautiful here. It's so amazing. Wow, look at that. Wow. I actually don't know what the pictures actually mean too. And have a look at that. There's an owl. There's a toucan. There's a Rio over there. That's so beautiful. Wow. I'm gonna admire this a little bit longer, and we're gonna take the orange line and we're gonna head straight to Shousan Zoo. Alright, so we have just gotten on the train station and we have to take the orange line from Formosa Boulevard to Sisihuan, and then after what we'll do is we'll change from that station to another one to get to the zoo. So the way you can actually tell which place to go to is it's quite simple to actually read. So see how it's got Formosa Boulevard and it's pointing that way? That kind of shows which direction the train is going to. So Sisihuan is number one, and five is Formosa, and it's going that way. So that's how we know that that's how we'll get to the destination to change. So on top of that here, they've got like the Formosa Boulevard station section map, some floor guides, as well as the system map here as well. So yeah, you can really see where you're going to. So we've got to head straight to, where is it? Sisihuan. So what will happen here is we'll be taking the green train to the zoo, and I'm just trying to figure out where we have to go to. Well, let me just have a quick look. We have to go to Gushan District Office and walk 12 minutes from there. So we've got to head from C14 to this area here, and we've got to walk 12 minutes to the zoo itself. So that's how you know that, that's how you know how to get to the destination itself. I'm just looking at Rome 2.io and actually experience that with you guys. So, all right, let's wait for the bus. It's also got 3 minutes until it comes, which says right here, next station to season one will arrive in 3 minutes. And they've got it all covered up. So here is also the walkway as well. So you stand behind this blue line, you enter here, and everyone exits in the middle. So you can walk to the left and the right side. And that's kind of how you get into the trains in Taiwan. All right, cool. Let's go straight to the zoo now. Change the station and then go straight to the zoo. Let's go, everyone. Okay, so we've just gone out that station, Sizihuan Station, and there's a big sign that says Hamasen Station, and this is where we're gonna go. It was very simple, the directions were right on the board. Just follow that outwards, and what you come to is this section right here. And I believe this is really close to P21, actually. I don't know if that's my train. I think I'm gonna miss it. No. That's all right. I'll just wait for the next train, but let me just show you how beautiful this place is. So this is the LRT. So we went from the MRT to the LRT. And here is where you take the next train. So let's go on. All right, so this is the actual map itself. And in the middle of the actual train, just over here, it actually tells you the direction you're going to. So when I had a look at that one, it said C16 going that way. I did miss that one. That was my station. So I've got 11 minutes left till the next one comes. But yeah, just on the top of that, see how we're here, C14, and we got to get to C17. It said when we was the next station, so we'll be following that one. So on the other hand, they've got C14 to C12, which is on that side. So like, oh, it's so windy. That's how you can kind of tell which station to go on and which platform to go on. So go in the middle, have a look at that, and then you'll know exactly where you need to go. All right, so we just got off Gushan office just over there, and it says it's gonna be a 30 minute walk. Oh my goodness. So what I'll be doing is I'm just gonna be going on Google Maps, and we're just gonna be walking straight up the hill, straight over there, to kind of see how long this road's gonna take and when we actually get to the zoo itself. So I'm gonna be following Google Maps just up there, and then I'll show you guys what to expect as soon as we get up there. Also the terrain and everything, I'll tell you guys, just so you're well prepared when you do come here. If you don't come here, then you can also know what to expect just when you go to Shousan Zoo. All right, so that was a bit of a slope going up there, but Google Maps tell us we should be turning left right here, and I can see some stairs there, but just like, you know that you're here because you've got this amazing temple here. It's such a beautiful view walking up. I'm just in awe with it. So yeah, we're gonna be going there now. So we're just gonna be crossing the road and taking these stairs up. I'm sure there's stairs here. It kind of looks like there's nothing here, but it said, Google Maps said it should be here. So it's, you know, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong, but there's like a really tight sort of area here. See? Yes, I'm right. So the stairs. So we're gonna walk up these stairs and we're gonna make our way to the zoo. Lego. All right, I really didn't expect this, but I'm actually walking on the actual road. So this is gonna be for another 10 to 15. I think there's some stairs going up, but 10 to 15 till we get there. So those were the stairs there, but I walked a little bit extra just to show you guys the view from here. It's amazing. Walking up this place, it's beautiful. We've got a while to go up there, but just admire this view for a bit before we head off. Talk about the pre-adventure to the actual adventure itself. That was a view I saw over there. I came up with Google Maps. There are toilets here. You do have to pay 10 Taiwan dollars to actually get a tissue, and there's a cafe and brunch here as well. So the Google Maps says we just have to walk a little bit more straight and then we should be able to get there. The other thing I wanted to note as well while walking here, if you are scared of monkeys, there are monkeys on the road too. They come about, they're on the roads, they're walking around, they're in the forest. So that's just one thing you need to know. If you are super scared of monkeys, just consider taking a bus up here instead. That was a hike already. And it's so cute, look at these. It's so funny, they say don't sit on it because I'm assuming people actually sit on that. That's so adorable. So, we've got a little bit more to go. And then hopefully we should get there. All right, guys, we have just bought a ticket and that was only 40 NT. So that's like 150 US dollars. All right, here's the zoo and there are some self-serve ticket machines. I went to the counter because they've got cash. And yeah, we're gonna head in there now and see what it's like. All right, so I'm gonna assume this is like a really small zoo. Let's have a look. Here's the map. So where do we come from? So we're right here. So we're just gonna go around here, around in a circle, and we should be able to finish this zoo. Awesome. All right, let's see what we have. Hello, meerkats. Ah, you guys are so adorable. Oh, look at them. I love when they stand up. Aren't they so adorable? All right, so these meerkats, they actually live in South Africa. And they have a social group of generally around like 6 to 30 members. Oh man, look at them, they're so cute. Ah, look at them go. Oh, you guys are so adorable. Let's see what else they have. Let's go. All right, so the meerkat's on one side. We are, don't know what that is. All right, so it seems like we actually have to walk a bit to see the next one. So cross habitat animal eco top. All right, well, let's go find that and show you guys what's next. So we have just seen the Malay sun bear. You can just see it, it's just over there. It's one of the smallest bears in Southeast Asia, and they usually eat fruits as well. And he's got like a massive place for him to lay and play over here. So here is the Malay sun bear. Very, very cute. But it says that they generally use their sharp claws to tear open tree holes, so that way they can get to the honey and the sap of the tree. There's only one of them there, but let's go check the next one. So we've just gotten to the ponies right here. So here are the ponies, and supposedly these guys actually live in like a social hierarchy for the males, and once they are old enough, generally what they do is they fight each other to mate. And even though they're small, they're quite strong and resilient. And back in the North American days, it just says here that they used to carry cargo or work underground in North American mines, is what I was trying to say. But now they're considered pets for children in the Western countries. So that's the history of ponies, and we're heading to the next one. I don't know if you guys can see this, but the crocodiles are right over there. And over there and there, and they're like underneath the water right now. So these guys can actually adapt to high salinity water, and they're the largest reptiles actually and have the widest distribution. So they're actually 7 meters in length, and they're highly territorial, so they will attack any animal that enters the territory, which includes humans, which is why they're one of the most probably scariest reptiles that you can find, besides actually you know, the other ones as well. I'm like trying to think which one were the other ones. I'm like, my mind's not working at the moment, but these guys are super dangerous in Australia. So we have just reached the American bison right here, and you can see him quite clearly over there. So these guys are the largest animal in North America. And what the males do is they hit each other in their foreheads to determine who's the leader of the group and for mating rights as well. So, these guys are actually the national animal now in America. So based on the description here, in May 2016, President Obama actually made this animal the national animal, which is on the same level of the status as their national animal, which is the bald eagle. So check that out, everyone. Here's one of America's national animal right there. All right, so the next animal that we're seeing right now is the one-humped camel. animal, which is right here with the description. So these guys are also called Arabian camels. So what they do is they have in the stomach, they have water storing sacs, and they can drink up to 100 liters of water at a time. So those humps over there is actually stored tissue fats to prevent hunger and thirst. So these guys are actually more taller than the actual two humped camels. It's got longer lashes, two layers of eyelids, and can close their nostrils. And the reason for that is because in the sand, they need to close their nostrils because the sand can go in as well. And they also have hair in their ears that prevents sand from entering as well. These guys are beautiful, aren't they? Usually found in the desert, but here they are in Taiwan right now. Beautiful things. Alright, so we have just reached a crested black macaw. So these guys are supposedly really rare. Look at them. So they generally communicate through gestures and voices as well. These guys are more rare in terms of the monkey species. These guys are the northern pig-tailed macaw. Their short tail is like a pig and a flat head with dark hair. They're often trained to actually pluck coconut and okay, so interesting. It actually says that it shows like a puckered face when it shows that it's provoked or intends to attack. So that's how you know when they're gonna come at you, when they've got like this, you know, sort of face. They look so peaceful here. He's massive. Oh, I didn't even see him. He's up there. Oh, that's cool. Let's go to the next one. These guys are called the Barbados Blackbelly Sheep. They're right here. And they're actually a crossbreed of European wool sheep and African hair sheep. And they were introduced to the Caribbean island of Barbados from West Africa in the 17th century by the Spanish and Portuguese people. So they're very highly adaptable to the environment and resistant to illness, which is capable of thriving in hot and humid areas. There's like quite a few of them in Barbados. I'm just gonna show you guys. There they are right there, there and there. And then the other thing we have right here as well is a donkey. And for all of you who watch Shrek, the donkey is the most funniest character there. I love it. So these guys are, let's have a quick look. Gray and brown, thin mane on the back. They're slower than horses, that's interesting. And they have better drought tolerances. It must be because they're quite small as well. And they can work under heat despite having limited access to food and water. So they're very invaluable animals used for transportation and cargo, but they've actually been more domesticated in the last 5,000 years. That's interesting. And if you look at them right now, they're actually quite small as well. So I'm surprised they're used for cargo. Super, super, super small. Oh, look at you, you're eating the... What's it called? It's a papaya? I think it's a papaya. Got the perfect view of this one here. So these guys here, they're actually white-haired gibbons. So they spend most of their time on trees. They also walk around with their hands up, which makes them really funny. The baby gibbon is generally raised by both the mother and father till 8 years old, and they use a very clear voice to actually sing early in the morning. So, and here is the fascinating gibbon right here, who's eating the papaya. Let's go to the next one. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, we have now reached the African elephant right here. And just while I was reading some of the facts, I found it so interesting because they are one of the actually one of the biggest heaviest and most dangerous land animal in the world. So these groups actually consist of a group of females and baby elephants, which are led by female elephants and not male elephants, believe it or not. These guys are, so both sexes actually have ivory tusks and ears twice as big as the actual Asian elephants itself. So they say that elephants are very smart and can become very good at understanding humans when trained. And believe it or not, 60% of the food that they eat becomes fecal material, which can be used to make paper and as burning material. Can you guys actually believe that elephant feces can actually make burning paper or paper in general? That's crazy. And there they are. It's funny, they don't look as big as the Asian elephants, but I'm assuming this African elephant is more of a baby version because she or he looks quite small and also very adorable as well. Let's go check the next one. Wow, look at this. This is an amazing cafe that they have here as well, which you can sit at the top. It's got quite a few levels and we're just heading straight to the... I'm just trying to see what other areas we have left that we haven't explored yet. So we got the bird enclosures and the savanna animal area. Let's walk this way. We have just reached the African lion. So here he is right here. And they are generally known as the king of beasts. So these guys generally live in a group and the female are responsible for hunting and raising the baby lions. Their eyes are very sensitive to moving objects and they can locate their prey from very far away as well. So these guys here, they have no endurance to run, but they can sneak attack their prey instead, which is very interesting because I actually thought that lions have massive endurance, but I think it's more like a sprinting sort of thing. There you go, there they are. All right, so these guys are the Boer goats and they're originally from South Africa. They have big, wide, droopy ears and the male horns are curved and thicker. And the female's horns are thinner and straight. Look at them eating, oh my gosh. So it says that they are always hungry and try to eat everything. So don't feed them everything because they will end up getting sick. Oh my goodness, look at him. I think you can pat them as well because this is a, what did it say? A kid-friendly zone. So generally with the kid-friendly zones, you can generally touch them. Oh, see how these ones, this one here is like much more straighter with the horn. Maybe she's a female. This one is definitely more of a male. See how it's like curved? You can see his... Wow. Let me just have a look at you.
Hi.
Hi. Wow, the horns are very sort of solid, I guess. And the fur feels like I'm touching a dog. Do you like your food?
Whoa! Oh shit, you scared the hell out of me.
I got scared. This guy just came out of nowhere. I was like touching the female. And this guy comes out of nowhere. Ah, you scared me, buddy. Hey, you scared me. Alright guys, this is what you can expect from the kid zone. And you walk around this whole area, comes back around here, and you come here, and then we're gonna go check outside, see what else there is. Hey, wait a minute, you're not part of the zoo. What are you doing?
That's what I was saying. There's also monkeys that are just like free as well at the zoo. It's so funny. Oh wow, there's two of them. Oh my goodness.
So if you're scared of monkeys, just beware, there are definitely monkeys here. I don't know if you can see these guys, but these guys are common elands and they weigh up to 1,000 kilograms. That's crazy. They don't look like 1,000 kilograms, but I guess they do weigh that amount. So both female and males have horns, but the female horns are generally thinner and longer. That's how you know the differentiation between them. And also, the other thing is like, these animals look very heavy, but supposedly they can actually jump over 1.5 meters high as well. So that's pretty cool. These guys.
So we have just reached the chimpanzee area. You see, They're like picking. Look, she's going up, she's going up. He or she, look at them. All right, so these guys are very similar to humans and demonstrate high levels of emotional expression, communication, cognitive and learning abilities. Look how cute they are. So they live in communities and are characterized by thick coats of black fur and flat faces. Look at them, oh, they're so adorable. It's like picking out like something from the hair. Wow. Yeah, so it says here that some male chimpanzees will even show even through objects to show aggression. So maybe it's throw, not through. But they use branches to extract honey, grass, to scatter white ants, and tools to crack some nutshells as well. So these are like probably like the closest we'd get. I don't know, maybe this has a better view. I think he's picking out something from her. Or maybe showing expression. That is really adorable. Alright, let's leave these intimate things together and go to the next place. Guys, we have just reached the Hippopotamus region. You can't really see them much because they're not really up, but you can see their heads over there. And these guys are actually one of the most dangerous animals in Africa. So supposedly they have a really bad temper and they're very offensive as well. So try not to get too close to them because like their mouths generally open like that. And they spend most of the day in water like that. And they only come out for food at night. So without their sweat glands, it secretes a red mucus to prevent the skin from getting too dry while ashore. So that's how they generally work. Cute little things, but also one of the most dangerous animals as well. So it's one thing we need to be careful about. Now, I was just looking in this area and we have reached these zebras. These zebras here are the Chapman zebras and alpacas as well. I actually can't see the alpacas, but here are the zebras. And these guys are black and white stripes. I'm just trying to have a look. So generally what they do is they express their emotions with their ears, straight up when calm, forward when shocked, and backwards when angry. So they also puff up when nervous and bark when seeing predators. Kind of reminds me of dogs where they, you know, they frown and they put it down, then they're angry and they put it up. And like, yeah, it's very interesting things. All right, where are the alpacas? We're just gonna see if we can find them. Oh, nope, they're not, that's not it. All right, guys, we're just gonna look and see what other animals they are. I really like the top of this pathway because it shows you like the ways of where to go and it kind of gives you like a big overview or top overview of like the animals itself. And there's like an open area here for you to really see, so like your eyesight's not really there's like not really an obstacle there for you, so it's like clear vision, so that's cool. I think this is a pretty cool place. Oh my gosh, they even have like the descriptions at the top too. This is really cool. Capybaras. So they're large rodents, webbed toes, fast drying fur, well adapted to both land and water. Now, whether we can find them or not is a different story. No, I can't find them. But here I find is actually a really cool area as well. Cover of pathways. Actually, maybe they're here. It says Hut of Capybara. All right, let's have a look. Can you guys find them? I actually can't find them. Interesting. So you can get a view of the bottom and a view of the top two, which I find is amazing. That's only if you can actually find the animals. No climbing. Alpacas. So that's the thing, I actually can't find the animals up here. I don't know if it's just me or I can't find them. Are they on this side? No, they're not.
Alright, I'm so confused right now. Like I said, the top is amazing if you can find the animals, which I have been horrible at finding the animals so far. So I'm just like, where are all the animals? I'm so confused right now. Alright, let's just try to find some more animals at the top.
I finally found my first animal at the top of this place. Here are the ponies. One, two, three. Ponies, ponies, ponies. Yay! They actually look better from the top, and I love how the view is not obstructed as well, so you can just really admire it. And because like there's trees here, it's a little bit shady as well. So you see how you got like your shades on this side too? I think it's a bonus being up here. Also, I like how they have like these like underground sort of areas too, which you can see on ground level with the animals itself. So if you can see here, here is the pony, and when you go down, you're like at eye level with them. This is pretty cool. Oh, it's very cool and air conditioned here too. Oh, that's the pony that we saw earlier, and I was standing over there. I actually think they were donkeys, not ponies. Here's the donkeys. There's the ox as well, but I just couldn't find the llamas. That's a nice view. I'm gonna go to the side, see what else they have, but I think we actually just reached the end. So this is what you can expect from the top level view. Let's go. I just found a white tiger.
Alright, so we've just finished our whole tour of this place. So we went from the cross habitat animal ecotype to aquatic animals to apes to savanna animals, kid farm, hut of black bear and animal trail. There's also a hut of capybara, but we could not find any, unfortunately, but that is okay. So that's what you can expect of this place. We are going to be walking out and we are going to say bye to Taiwan's zoo at Kaohsiung. So just in terms of the review itself, I think it was a very, very value for money sort of activity. It is a little bit out of the way in terms of like heading up into like the mountains itself, but other than that, I'd say you'd have to be semi-fit to be able to do this, because there is a lot of walking around, walking at the top, walking at the bottom to see the animals. There is there is a train service there as well, so like a train that takes you around to each area and it stops there for you, so you can use that as well. But I would say it'll take around 1 to 2 hours to finish this whole tour of the zoo, depending on how sort of fast you are. If you like to appreciate animals and just like watch them a little bit more, or you're like the type to just quick and go, like if you're the quick and go type, then probably like maybe 40 minutes to an hour if you walk quick. So that's what you can expect of this zoo itself. And value for money, definitely. I only spent $150 to actually go in there. It was a little bit of trek up, but other than that, it was a great place to go to here in Kaohsiung, Taiwan. So if you like this video, like, comment, and subscribe, and we'll be back for more travel videos. All right, see you guys later. Bye, everyone.